You know, this is directly my fault.
Welcome to Wow of True, the podcast of your wildest memes.
We talk about niche internet fame, interview people who are making it on the internet, and chart our own misguided quest for online attention. I'm your dead girl walking, Isabel.
I am pretty sure I'm alive, but I'm not sure. My name's Amanda. Anyone could be famous on the internet, so why not us?
On July 21st, 2021, Tumblr, dead social media site, zombie content churn walking, decided it was going to start monetizing. In 2021, the horse has left the building. It's kind of late. Bear with me. This is the cold open anecdote, which I promise we are going somewhere with. Tumblr announced Post Plus, which meant that Tumblr users could begin to monetize their content, making some posts require quote unquote unlocking, as in a sort of tiered payment structure. Now, this isn't a novel idea. Patreon has posts that are hidden from non-patrons. Twitter is, I believe, rolling out paid tweets at some point, or maybe it has. Substack has similar locked slash unlocked structures. Most site users accept a certain amount of paid infrastructure. But because this is Tumblr, all hell broke loose. Hell is sort of an exaggeration, but here's kind of what ended up happening in the next 24 hours.
So, hashtag some personal news. I have a sort of real job now. I'm reporting on social media and other consumer-facing stuff for TechCrunch, and that ties into this episode because I was reporting on the Tumblr drama and cannot believe that I got paid real human dollars to think about Tumblr drama all day. But that's what happened to me.
Well, I mean, okay, so people who are getting their posts monetized while also being paid real human dollars to think about Tumblr all day, so you know.
Yeah, it is connected, and I think that does get at the themes that we're going to talk about in this episode of, like, how come some forms of monetization are considered kosher and some are considered selling out. But anyway, so I wrote two articles about Post Plus. One was just more of a straight up news story explaining what happened. And then when all hell broke loose, I did more of a longer thing about, like, why did all hell break loose? Basically, on Tumblr, as it existed before Post Plus, you could just post things, and there wasn't really a way for creators to monetize their content on the platform. So sometimes people would link to, like, their Patreon or their Ko-fi, that's K-O-F-I Ko-fi, where people could tip them. And then once that came to Tumblr, the platform itself, again, all hell broke loose.
To clarify, Post Plus isn't out yet, other than kind of being in a beta. I believe one person has used it, and that's another story we need to talk about.
It is more than one person, but there was one Tumblr user, Kaijuno, who really bore the brunt of the backlash instead of Tumblr itself. I did interview Kaijuno for my longer story, and they were kind of like, I was just trying to, like, get some money to pay my medical bills, and then I got death threats. And I think that's fucked up, and nobody should be giving somebody death threats for, like, trying to make money on Tumblr.
Wait, but back up. So we're starting at the middle. Talk about, like, how, what happened during the day timeline.
Yeah, so I believe Tumblr gave, like, an exclusive to the Wall Street Journal. And then once the Wall Street Journal posted, then they emailed a bunch of other journalists, including me. And I was like, fuck yeah, I'm gonna write about Tumblr monetizing. Like, I've been training my entire life for this. So I wrote just, like, a generic news post. But also, I think it's worth noting, Tumblr was doing really well as a website and having, like, generally a positive growth trajectory. And then, you know what happened in 2018?
What happened in 2018?
They took the porn away.
How could they take the porn away? That's what everyone's here on Tumblr for.
Yeah, so it turned out that, like, about a third of Tumblr's user base just fled the platform. Apparently, one third of the people were there for the porn. That's not a fair statistic you can draw, but essentially.
You know, this is a really respectable podcast where you can get your facts just straight up about porn and how many people on the internet are here for it.
Yeah, so ever since then, since January 2019 until now, I have the graph, I have the stats. Tumblr's user base has remained relatively stagnant. Mm-hmm. There still are 300 million page views a month, at least.
That's shocking to me. That's, like, too many. Tumblr doesn't deserve that.
But as a social media company, it's kind of a bad thing if you're not having any growth over like a 2-year period.
Well, that's not shocking to me because Tumblr has been sold to multiple companies over the past, like, I want to say like decade for increasingly less and less money. It's almost a joke on the site at this point. Like, I'm saying this as someone who heavily uses Tumblr in 2021, which is like, you know, a choice I'm making with my body in mind, which you should not be making with your body in mind, where it's almost a joke at this point that Tumblr is A, unmonetizable, B, none of the companies that have been purchasing Tumblr know what to do with it, C, we're being kept around as test subjects for like random things companies want to do. And it's almost a point of pride, which is why I think the user base reacted so negatively to monetization.
And speaking of Tumblr being owned by companies, that reminds me that nothing I say on this podcast is reflective of TechCrunch.com. I don't know what the rules are, but WoW True Life is separate from TechCrunch.com life, despite the fact that I am referencing things I reported for TechCrunch.com.
I think Tumblr is an interesting case study, actually, just because it's a weird situation regarding monetization and content and like the architecture necessary to sustain like monetized content creation. It actually shocks me that Tumblr has had a relatively steady page view count over the past few years, because I would have thought it would have been going downwards. Like, everyone talks about how Tumblr is dead and Tumblr is like off the sidelines, like, I'm still alive. Sometimes I can still hear his voice. But first and most importantly, so you referenced Destiel, Amanda, in your article, and that actually did kind of get the community up in arms. Like, I saw this one post circulating where people were like, my god, the journalist referenced Destiel and Destiel fanfic and monetization of Destiel fanfic, and I felt like, you know, this is directly my fault.
Speaking of TechCrunch.com, I'm a very respectable journalist, and sometimes I like to just include words in articles and then be like, haha, I wrote that word on TechCrunch.com. And I wanted to write Destiel on TechCrunch.com. But this does bring up another point of, I don't know if people were up in arms about me saying Destiel so much as they were up in arms about the idea of monetizing fan content, which, to be clear, in the emails that Tumblr sent to journalists, they were like, now people can monetize whatever they want, whether it's shitposting or fan art. And then on Tumblr Post Plus blog itself, it was like, everything from shitposting to fan art. So, you know, the two genders, shitposting and fan art.
They did also explicitly mention fanfic in one of the posts, and they also explicitly mentioned, like, oh yeah, our lawyers say it's fine. And I, someone who took the bar, other personal news, I took the bar exam. It was a hot trash fire of a nightmare. We're not gonna talk about it. We're like, this is sus, Tumblr. This is sus of you to say.
I think that being a community that's so ingrained in fandom, for example, friend of the pod, Allison, pointed out to me that on the App Store for a while, Tumblr called itself Tumblr, home of fandom. I think given that Tumblr quite literally is a home of fandom, people reacted very badly to the idea of monetizing fan content because they know from experience that that can be a really treacherous idea. And I think even on AO3, you're literally not allowed to link to like a coffee or a Patreon or anything, because that could be construed as like profiting off of content. Also, I mean, this is why I think it's funny that like it's sort of a meme at this point, but like everybody on their fanfic is like, these characters are property of Disney.
So it's interesting actually, because you can see a cultural shift between people who experienced Anne Rice suing everybody and teenagers who have never experienced getting sued and have like content that is on sites that is going to protect them. Like AO3, like regardless of how you feel about AO3, does have lawyers and does like aggressively try to make sure that fanfic will be protected in a way that was maybe not the case when like fanfic was hosted on like random people's websites in 2005. This is also your daily reminder that this is not legal advice and I am not your lawyer. That being said, this is actually a really interesting situation regarding copyright, because there's enough stuff to talk about here to make a whole episode, but Tumblr saying yes, monetize your fanfic is hashtag problematic in a lot of ways. Kind of as a backdrop to everything, let's just make it clear, this is America. You could be sued or sue at any time. That's your right as an American. If you're not an American listening to this, fuck you. This is not how any of this works. But basically, copyright works so that the original copyright owner can technically sue for copyright infringement regarding any derivative fan works. I'm highly cutting this down to size. This, if anyone, Sarah, if you're listening to this, if I get stuff wrong, that's on me. But whether it's worth anyone's time regarding suing someone is another question. At this point in history, individual users are, at this point, not likely to be sued, in my opinion. So if you monetize your fanfic, it's not likely you're going to get anything worse than a cease and desist, and that's even a maybe. Like, who are you? It doesn't really matter.
Yeah, I mean, I know what it's like to get a cease and desist and freak out and then have Isabel tell me, Amanda, it doesn't matter. They think we're funny.
Yeah, you know, this is an experience you, random listener, you, Craig, could also have.
Then again, we did cease and also desist.
So the real issue here is that if there's sort of a big cultural shift toward monetization of fan work, that's something that maybe gets Disney's mouse ears perked, and Disney is notoriously litigious. The other thing here is that Tumblr has explicitly said that they're not going to protect anyone who uses the site. Some people online have been saying that's a problem. I actually don't think that's a problem at all, because all sites basically have a limitation of liability thing. This is getting boring. This is technical. Mm-hmm. But basically, it's not anything any individual user should be worried about, but we should be maybe concerned with a site trying to fuck with copyright law.
I think what's also so wild is that in their press copy, they could have easily been like, oh, you can monetize your original artwork or like your writing, but they had to say your fanfic.
They did have to say fanfic. Like, what was the reason for this?
Yeah, and it's just...
You have no words. You're done.
I have no words. Actually, no, I have a lot more words. I have too many words in me. But I mean, moving on. So content monetization itself, aside from whether or not you're going to get sued by Disney, a big question for me still is how come certain types of monetization on certain platforms are considered kosher? Whereas, like, correct me if I'm wrong, Tumblr expert Isabel, but I feel like if somebody has a Patreon, like, linked on their Tumblr, that's not really unkosher. I also interviewed somebody for my article who was like, they are Tumblr user normal-horoscopes, but they make money on Patreon that supports them, and their Patreon audience comes from Tumblr. So this person is essentially making a living off of Tumblr by extension.
God, I wish that were me.
Yeah, but that's not considered bad. But this person was very against Post Plus monetization. And I'm very curious about, like, I feel like a lot of people reacted similarly where they feel like platforms like Patreon are very upfront about, like, we are a platform that helps creators make money. And Tumblr isn't that.
I think it's less that Tumblr users are against monetization and more that they're against the specific way Post Plus rolled out or is going to roll out. Putting aside the fact that Tumblr users don't trust Tumblr, which is a whole different story about giving a website your credit card information and whether you think they're competent enough to use it.
I've seen that argument circulate a lot, but I think that we're also forgetting that the current owner of Tumblr, Automatic, which owns WordPress.com, not WordPress.org. There is a difference between WordPress.com and WordPress.org, but that's a company that so many people trust with their payments.
Okay, but see, this is like the fourth company that's owned Tumblr at this point. And Tumblr users aren't thinking about parent companies, right? They're thinking about the 5 million times Tumblr has fucked up and like how many viruses have gone on the site and like all the shitty ways in which applications have been rolled out. I think the thing we're not talking about here is the fact that every time Tumblr has rolled out a new feature, Tumblr users have bitched about it for like at least a week.
Yeah.
Tumblr users hate change, and part of it's valid because Tumblr itself, when they roll out new features, like about 70% of the time the feature is broken. The other 30% of the time it's like, you changed the color of the background. Nobody asked for this. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing that I think is funny is that you know about XKit, right?
Oh, I used XKit back in like 2012.
Great news. In 2021, it's still alive and well. Well, I think it's XKit too at this point.
We gotta have XKit on the podcast. They're truly like American hero. I don't know if they're from America, but whatever country they're from, they're heroes of that country.
World heroes.
World heroes. International superstars, XKit.
Yeah. But the thing is that Tumblr users will actively roll back changes.
Yes.
Which I don't think you see happening on any other website. So I think there's like a level of entitlement here that other sites don't need to deal with.
Yeah. I feel like when I used XKit, it was like, it made it easier to tag your posts, and it made it easier. Like, I think I was in Tumblr in the era when if you reblogged something, you reblogged the other person's tags.
People still do that.
Ah, that's fucked up. But because, like, tags are, like, the subtext. Tags are the meta text. And if you're reblogging somebody else's reaction, then it looks like your reaction.
Hey, you know what's fucked up?
Tumblr.
Yes, you're right.
Tumblr's a broken website.
Yeah, and that's why people are mad about the monetization.
Now I'm angry. Tumblr really is broken.
So you get it now, right?
Why is XKit, like, you would think, like, after 10 years of people actively using an application that rolls back Tumblr's changes and makes it better, like, why hasn't Tumblr just, like, acquired XKit or, like, paid XKit to, like, do shit for them?
Literally, I don't know. They really should just hire XKit and have XKit run the website. Like, it would be better. But see, now you see why, like, the Tumblr user base gets mad about these things.
Oh, and I mean, I do think that, like, you could argue that Post Plus also was rolled out in a broken way, and that one of the things that people also got very mad about is, let's say you are a user, which only a handful of users have access to Post Plus. They were, like, handpicked. There is information going around that it was exclusively Kaijuno. That's not true, but what is true is that Kaijuno did really bear the brunt of the criticism and got death threats, and that's fucked up, and they should have never been put in that situation. So if you are one of the people who has access to Post Plus and somebody subscribes to you, and then you want that person to not be subscribed to you for whatever reason, there could be a lot of reasons. Internet harassment is unfortunately alive and well. You can't block them on your own. You have to contact Tumblr support. And Tumblr did tell me that they're going to make it so that you can block somebody on your own in the future if they are subscribed to you on Post Plus. But, like, that feels like a very important privacy feature to have embedded in the system to start.
Yeah, that was also a big concern people had. But yeah, I don't think it's that people are against monetization. I think they're just against the way that Post Plus does monetization.
I do think it's a little naive, and to borrow the word entitled that you used, to assume that Tumblr can remain as it is forever when this is a company that hasn't had significant user growth in like 2 years after the great porn ban of 2018. And companies need money to survive. And this sort of brings us to an issue with the current iteration of social media, is that, like, Facebook is supported by ads.
Tumblr does have ads. They're just insane.
But then they are still considering rolling out ads to individual people's blogs.
They did that for a while. People had ads on their blogs and you had to, like, opt out of it. It was, like, a whole thing.
I think that was, like, in beta.
This conversation is, like, totally just, like, what Tumblr is like. It's like, are they doing a thing? Who knows? They say they're not doing it. They did it, like, 3 years ago. It's fine.
But companies need money to survive, and I don't think it's fair to critique companies for trying to make money when they need money to operate. But I think that there are some platforms that have a similarly hashtag quirky user base to Tumblr.
You could just say insane. It's okay. They're all crazy.
There are other platforms that are doing this in a better way. And I feel like the issue with Post Plus is that Tumblr was trying to be Twitter, when what if Tumblr was trying to be Discord or Reddit? And this is when we turn it to you to explain to us how Discord and Reddit monetize.
Yeah, so Reddit and Discord work on a monetization model where basically content is free and reactions to content are paid. For example, awarding someone Reddit gold. This does nothing for anybody, but you can pay to give someone Reddit gold. And people do that a lot. And this works really well in a space where interactions are high volume, but the actual content is sort of worthless. I think the fundamental mistake that Tumblr made is assuming that posting has any value, which I know is a controversial and a very high level statement to make here in about a website that consists only of posting. But the fundamental mistake that Tumblr made is assuming that its user base values posts.
So I feel like you're right in a comedic sense, but in a literal sense, I don't think you're right.
No, but like what I'm saying here is more that monetization of posts and Post Plus is more like if you had to pay to read a Reddit comment in the eyes of the current user base. You're not going to pay for an individual Reddit user's Reddit comment, even if it's like a really long or really like well-written Reddit comment, because sometimes those comments are actually really good, but like you're not going to pay for it because there's 1,000 other people who are talking about stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And this is even more so on websites where everyone is using pseudonyms or anonymous features, basically, which is how it differs from Twitter, because like a Twitter post, Twitter and monetization of Twitter posts is probably likely to be more successful just because people on Twitter are using their real names and you maybe want to hear what Lil Nas X wants to say.
Oh, I always want to hear what Lil Nas X wants to say.
I would pay a couple dollars for that, I'm not gonna lie. But I'm not going to pay for, I'm so sorry, Tumblr user, normal horoscopes. I'm not gonna pay for Post Plus for you, even if I would give you a couple dollars on Patreon.
Well, Tumblr user, normal horoscopes said that they don't want to use Post Plus anyway, so you know, it's a win-win situation.
So this works out for everybody. And like, the argument I'd make here is that Tumblr is a lot more like 4chan than it is like Twitter.
That's safe to say, again, in a very literal context.
And like, I have some other theories about why Post Plus was rolled out in the way it was, because I think maybe what's going on is that they're trying to attract influencers or other creators back on the platform by introducing a native monetized feature. And in fact, the native user base is not in fact the target audience at all.
Even in the press information that was sent to press people, it did say that it was geared toward Gen Z, and they shared stats that over 48% of Tumblr users currently are Gen Z, and Gen Z users spend 26% more time on the platform than non-Gen Z people.
So does this make me Gen Z? Does my Tumblr usage really tip that in favor of me being Gen Z?
I feel like in past episodes, we've made the incorrect assumption that since we were born within a few months of each other, we would both either be Gen Z or millennials. But even though I'm younger than you, I think that because I'm obsessed with Chugi, I'm a millennial. And because you use Tumblr, you're Gen Z.
I like that. Yeah, it's not a time-based, but like a content usage-based theory of millennial and Gen Z. I think that fits.
Yeah, and I do think it's worth noting that it's a little bit unfair to make a comparison of like, oh, well, why can't Tumblr do what Reddit and Discord are doing? Because like we don't know how much money these features are yielding for Reddit and Discord compared to Post Plus, or like, it's very hard to make assumptions about if Tumblr did this, would they make enough money to continue being the wild west of the internet? But it is worth pointing out that not all monetization is created equal. Speaking of me being Chugi.
Yeah, we're replacing our usual putting each other on blast segment with a new and exciting segment that is just to the left called How Much Do You Think This Post Is Worth? And Amanda, I would like to read this post to you that you posted from the WoW True Pod Twitter. And also shout out again to Sarah, who messaged me about this being like, did you post this? And I was like, I've been actively trying to stop Amanda from posting about this. And I have not succeeded. Okay, so Amanda posted, I find it kind of funny. I find it kind of sad. The dreams in which I'm Chugi are the best I've ever had. I think you should be paying me money for the fact that I had to read it. I think this is worth negative money.
I think that this tweet is worth approximately 12 likes, which is the amount of likes it got.
Okay, but give me a monetary sum. How much do you think someone should pay to read that tweet? You've heard my theory about this, which is you should pay me to read that tweet.
The real question is, do I owe money to the British band Tears for Fears, who released the song Mad World in 1982? Is this fanfic of the song Mad World?
Ooh, this might be Mad World fanfic, yeah.
Yeah, so can I monetize this content? And if I put it behind Post Plus on Tumblr, would I get sued by Tears for Fears?
I think Tears for Fears is not Disney, and they would be nice and they would not sue you.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is also derivative work, so you're safe to put this under Post Plus.
Okay.
You're probably fine. That being said, emotionally, spiritually, you should be paying people to read it.
After you're very mean to me, I'm going to be very nice to you and point out a tweet that you made on July 29th where you say, someone should write a TTRPG that plays using Magic 8 Ball instead of a D6/20/etc. I think that this is a monetizable small business idea.
Now I feel bad about being mean to you, but thank you.
I mean, how would this work? It's like, instead of rolling for initiative, you shake the magic eight ball, and if it says that you're feeling good, then you get to attack first.
Yeah, something like that. So I was thinking about this because I was trying to think of a structure that would let you shake the magic eight ball instead of rolling a number of dice. And the thing is, a magic eight ball has, I looked this up, 10 positive answers, 5 like eh answers, and then 5 negative answers, which I think gives you actually a pretty good range of options for a TTRPG.
So is a magic 8 ball a d20?
A magic 8 ball may be a d20, yeah.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, fuck. You know, maybe I do need to write
yeah.
this.
Yeah. I mean, it really does work. Like, I mean, as you were talking, you were like 10, 5, and 5, and I was like, oh, man, that 10, 5, and 5, that's 20. That's a d20.
That's a d20. Oh, do you want to hear my other business idea that I didn't post about? TTRPG that plays using a Ouija board, and all decisions have to be made with the DM fighting you against the Ouija board to, like, make words happen. Less monetizable, but more funny.
I really think that we're onto something here.
You know, we're going to really pivot and we're going to stop being a podcast and start being a game design company.
Awesome.
And, you know, we're going to make so much more money because let's talk about our content monetization. Let's take this personal. How successful have we been? Because we use Patreon. Like, I guess disclaimer, because we've talked about Patreon today. We have a Patreon and you should give us money because we want it.
I think we've been unsuccessful at monetizing our content.
Yeah, I feel like we could be a lot more successful at monetizing our content. I think we need to open up a store or something. I don't know if anyone's going to buy our stuff.
I really think that we should make a t-shirt that says the dreams in which I'm Chugi are the best I've ever had.
Jesus fucking Christ. Maybe we should really return to our roots and start making just weird t-shirts again.
Yeah, our root really is being a weird t-shirt business. We did make a t-shirt once that said, "For the rich."
I still have that in my closet. I think I have like 3 of those in my closet right now. And I have to hide them from my mother. I just cannot explain for to her. I don't want to do that. So it's really a struggle when I'm living at my parents' place.
All right, well, t-shirt store coming soon to wowtrue.com.
I feel like we're actually going to do this.
Except instead of us hand-making it, it would realistically be like a print-to-order thing.
Yeah, it would be a print-to-order thing. But I think coming up with weird t-shirt slogans that actually sell is actually our strong suit.
Yes, I think this is our talent. We did raise multiple $1,000s when Isabella drew an image of Donald Trump being attacked by cats leading up to the 2016 election. And we didn't even get a cease and desist that time.
God, if we had gotten a cease and desist from Donald Trump, that would have made me really happy. That would have been funny as hell. So yeah, I don't know. Like, my hot take is that like Tumblr reacts so negatively to monetization is that it's like more of a pre-commercial web application that because of its mismanagement over like the past decade and still exists in that like pre-monetization phase. And it has more in common, like I said, with 4chan than Facebook. And then this is in contrast to TikTok, which is like a native, like aggressively commercial application. It's basically all people's faces, people's real names. Everyone is trying to sell you something or sell something from their small business, which don't get me wrong, that's super valid. Like people should like make that bread. But what's interesting is that TikTok is basically all Gen Z. I don't have any statistics here because I'm not the journalist.
Not to make assumptions and call them statistics, but I do think it's safe to say that TikTok is very dominated by Gen Z.
Yeah, so and because of that, what's interesting is that the content on TikTok aggressively resembles 2014 Tumblr and cringe, which makes me think that Tumblr is trying to like get some of those people back. I don't know. I just have theories. I'm putting on my tinfoil hat.
I think that's a safe theory, given that the marketing of Post Plus was very much like this is a Gen Z monetization tool. Which, what does that even mean, really? Because it's like, I mean, I guess monetization can sort of be generational because, as you point out, it's like we're in an era of the internet where we're more aware of ads and whatnot. And I mean, another statistic that I have in my back pocket because I'm a hashtag tech journalist now is that, you know how on iOS, like recently, you started getting pop-ups that were like, do you want to allow this app to track your usage across other apps? There's data that 96% of people opted out of that.
That tracks.
I think like people care about privacy on the internet and people know that they're being constantly marketed to and constantly faced with ads. I mean, Facebook and Instagram in particular are like really ramping up their e-commerce features. Mm-hmm. Instagram is owned by Facebook, for those who don't know. So it's like if Instagram does something, Facebook kind of does it too in a way. Mm-hmm. But like it is really exhausting to be like, I am constantly being marketed to. And the marketing works. Like Instagram advertises me weird earrings all the time. And I love weird earrings and I buy them.
God damn it. They really got you, huh?
They really got me. And I think that on certain communities, I think the TikTok community is maybe more okay with this sort of advertising than Tumblr, because even on TikTok, you have these accounts that are like not even run by, for example, Target. And there are entire very popular TikTok feeds devoted to things at Target you need to buy.
Yeah, no, because I mean, the thing is that I think that there's been a big shift in advertising from commercials and like things that are like explicitly advertisements to promoted products. This is like how we can talk about how like influencers get free products just so that they can show them to their followers on social media.
Oh yeah, and then I significantly benefit from this because other friend of the pod, Zoe, is an influencer and sometimes she gets so much stuff that she gives me the leftovers. So I have some free skincare products I've been using. It's great. I love it.
So maybe advertising is good, actually, but it's one of those things where I think studies have shown that this is more effective on Gen Z in general than normal advertising, and it's aggressively more effective, which is why you've seen such a big pivot to that. Anyway, I don't know. Capitalism is bad, but like also websites need money to run. So there's a complicated interplay here.
And I do think the bottom line of all of this is that Twitter can't monetize in the same way as Tumblr, in the same way as TikTok, in the same way as Reddit, etc. And I think that where Tumblr really messed up here and got the community mad, besides just Tumblr people getting mad at everything all the time, is that they didn't take the community's general disposition into account when rolling out this feature. I think the most interesting thing I learned in my reporting was I talked to an anonymous source who is a former Tumblr employee who told me that this feature initially was pitched as a tip jar. And, and like, this was coming from people whose jobs positioned them to be more connected to the community. And then once it got into the hands of higher ups who are not as engaged with the Tumblr community, it kind of got turned into Post Plus. And I think this shows that, like, people who work directly with the community know what the community wants.
So what I'm hearing here is that we need to oust the higher ups and seize the means of production.
I don't know if I can legally comment.
All right, on that note, if you liked this episode, tell a friend. Word of mouth is how we grow. And maybe leave us a review on iTunes. We do read those. We love to read them. Thank you to everyone who left a review so far, and thank you to all of our Patreon patrons. Shout out to Zoe Stoller, Dan McKeon, and Bray specifically. Another shout out to Sam Rizer, who made our podcast music. You can find us online at wowftrue.com or on Twitter as @wowftruepod, where Amanda is posting about Chugi constantly. I'm kidding. I'm being mean, but she is posting. And Instagram and Facebook as @wowftrue. If you want to throw us a couple of dollars, slide right into our Patreon at patreon.com/wowoftrue. Monetization keeps the content flowing. No, seriously, we love cash and we love to have it. If you've had your 15 seconds of fame or know someone who has, slide right into our Twitter DMs and tell us about them. And until next time, let's get famous on the internet.